Good evening, I'm Selwyn Collins of CWS Conversations with Selwyn. Thank you for joining us this evening, and those of you who are joining us for the first time, a very special thank you. CWS is about having conversations with people about their journeys and how they're using their gifts and talents to help others. And so I'm always looking for people who are doing extraordinary things or doing things extraordinarily well. This evening's topic about natural hair is something I think that is very important for us to have a conversation on. And so I've invited someone who is sort of an expert, for the lack of a better word, on the field. She's been in the industry for 12 to 15 years. So I'm hoping that by the end of this conversation, we'll not only learn about her, but we'll learn more about natural hair, why we do it, and I'll take a short break, and then when I return, I'll introduce you to our guest for the night. Lovely lady next to me is Maxine Green. Maxine, good evening.
Good evening. How are you?
I am fine, thanks, and welcome to CWS.
Thank you so much. Thanks for having me.
Maxine, I just want to go straight into it. Maxine, a hairstylist for 15 years, trained and worked at a prestigious Devachan.
That's correct.
Devachan Salon, New York, trained and worked as a platform artist and technical advisor Schwarzkopf.
Schwarzkopf
Professional Multi-Texture Specialist. This phrase, I am natural, so what? What comes to mind when you hear this sentence, and what is your general attitude to those who are reluctant to adopt a natural look?
I would want to know why. There's so many reasons why someone would go natural. It's, first of all, it's much more healthier. I'm just a firm believer in whatever you put into your body, it's what's going to come out on your skin. So if I get that general rebuttal of, I don't know, why go natural? It's not professional, because that's the first thing everyone thinks. Natural hair is not professional. So I would want to know why. And that would be my question. Well, why?
Where were you born? And can you give us a glimpse into the 8-year-old Maxine, who she was at 16 and who she became at 21?
Wow. A good question. No one has ever asked me that before. I was originally born in Montreal, Canada. My parents are from Guyana, Georgetown, Guyana. 8-year-old Maxine was growing up in Guyana, running barefoot in the yard, in the backyard, running behind the boys and climbing trees. Think she was a tomboy. 21, I thought I was grown. I had my first child at 21. And I was pretty much a mom at 21. So I was 21.
Growing up in Guyana, so what values do you remember as a child or from childhood that's shaped who you are today?
I always remembered my uncle, God bless his soul, Uncle Robert and Uncle Roy. I remember him saying to me as a little girl, don't drink alcohol when you go outside. Drink it at home so that no one have to call me and tell me how you were acting a fool in the streets or acting crazy. So I always remembered him saying to us, be yourself at home so that no one can call me and complain about you.
When I ask you this question this way about what people think about you, if you were to eavesdrop a conversation between your mother or a conversation with your mother, your husband, and your daughter, telling a stranger or telling some people about you, what do you think each of them would say about you? Starting with mom.
Oh my God. That's a good question. I don't know. But if I was to guess, I would say my mom. I adore my mom. I'm the middle of seven. And in my mom's eyes, I could do no wrong. And so, I suppose my mom would say, She's a good daughter. She's very loving and very thoughtful. That's what my mom would say.
And your daughter?
My daughter, I would say this of my daughter because she's always told me. She always wanted to be like me. And I think it's the best compliment anyone could ever give me.
Mm-hmm.
She's always wanted to, she wants to cook like me. She wants to dress like me. She wants to look like me. I think my daughter's way prettier than me. But she's always said to me, Mom, I just want to be just like you. So.
And your husband?
He's always said to me, I love you for who you are. And I love you for the person that you are. You're very thoughtful and you're caring.
Mm-hmm.
And you think about others.
You've worked at some prestigious salons and so on.
Mm-hmm.
How does one get to work for one of those establishments? And for young people trying to get into the door, what are their four steps?
Do you know, it's a funny story. Excuse me. Devashan was by fluke. I don't believe in accidents, but I answered an ad that was on Craigslist for the Devashan salon. And at the time I was working in Brooklyn on Albany Avenue. And I knew I wanted to do something different. I wanted more education for myself. And so I answered an ad. And I had no idea what the company was or even what they did.
Mm-hmm.
And I walked in and I sat down. I'll never forget it. It was like a Monday. It was a Monday and I'll never forget it. I had two interviews with two different salons in Soho. And the first salon I went to, I didn't have my resume. And I said, he said, well, we need your resume. I was like, okay, I'm going to go print it. And I left to go to Kinko's and never made it to Kinko's. I said, you know what? I call up Devashan and I said, listen, I'm in the area. I know my interview is tomorrow, Tuesday. Can I come in? And he said, yeah. And I went in. And the rest is history. So I guess to answer your question, I say go for what you want.
Mm-hmm.
Don't let fear be the guiding factor to hold you back. Because fear can cripple you. And I'm a firm believer in speaking to what you want and speaking to existence and what you want. So,
outside your parents, who would you say have had the greatest influence on you?
In terms of career or just as a person?
You know what? Let's take both that you brought them up.
In my personal life, my children.
Mm-hmm.
My children are shaped and molded. Because I had to grow up really fast to be a mom. And I had to learn how to be a mom. So I was a young mom. I had
mm-hmm.
to learn how to be a mom and to be a responsible mom.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of life, I've had a lot of people who has touched and crossed paths with me that I admire. But I must say, the one person that really kind of pulled me aside and said, you know what, you're talented beyond your dreams. And I've never, it's so crazy, I've never believed that until she pulled me aside. And her name is Shari Harbinger. And at the time, she was the academy director for Devashan Salons. And she said to me, Maxine, you're very talented. You need to believe in yourself.
So when did you first notice this passion for hair?
I've always had a passion for hair. Always. I've always wanted to do hair. I've always been doing hair. I've been doing hair since I was 14. But it didn't really resonate with me until later on in my life.
Mm-hmm.
When I love everything about here. And sometimes I look at it and I'm working and I can't believe people actually pay me to do what I do. But it feels good.
I have to ask you this. What is it in your experience and training that gives you the confidence to talk about here the way you do?
Gives me the confidence. Because I love it. I love the impact. I love, it's like instant gratification when someone, when a woman sits in my chair, it could be a woman of any age, but I just love the instant gratification I get when they look at their hair and I'm like, I love it. I love my hair. Oh my God, thank you so much. That for me is the biggest tip in the world, because you can see their appreciation. And when they say to me, no one has ever really took the time to educate me and really talk to me as though I'm a human being. I'm a human being, and not really talk down to me, which in our industry, it could be. But I just love what I do.
So what are your thoughts about more and more women of color choosing to wear their hair in natural styles?
I love it. I love it. I say embrace it. Own it. I say go for it. Absolutely embrace it. I get chills when I see more and more women wearing their hair in a natural state. However that may be, whether it's locks or their hair is just out in a natural texture. And I think one of the things that women find, that if I stop relaxing or I stop using any form of chemicals in my hair, minus color, because color is a chemical, of course, but minus color. But any form of chemical that alters the texture of the curl, you know, they think it's not okay.
Right.
You know, especially women in corporate America, like lawyers. And, you know, I have clients who are lawyers and doctors, and, you know, they're like, oh, it's too pro-black, or it's too... And I say, no, it's not. It's just who you are.
Talking about corporate America, what have your clients who are in corporate America, what have they been saying to you about the acceptance of natural hair and how it might impact their opportunities for promotion?
You know what? I haven't heard anything about that. I think there's such a shift in our community right now, in our society, that it's more acceptable. Maybe years ago, I remember years ago, I worked for, before I became professional and decided to follow my heart and my dreams of being a professional hairdresser, I was working for S&P, McGraw-Hill, which is a very corporate America. And I remember for 4 years, they never saw what my hair looked like. My head was wrapped like Erykah Badu. And I remember getting comments from my manager at the time. Oh, if I wear a turban like that, I don't know what my hair would be like. I don't know how it would feel. And those were the kind of comments. But I think it's, compared then to now, it's shifted so much. Mm-hmm. I think it's a lot more accepting. I think as long as you keep it looking professional, I think there's nothing wrong with it. So I haven't heard anything from clients or even colleagues that says it's...
And in 1979, let's go back a little bit in time, there's a movie called 10 with Bo Derek. Yeah, right. And what that did, it sort of created an industry, an economic industry for Caribbeans, especially people in the islands, to braid hair of the tourists that would visit the various islands and so on. Mm-hmm. How much of an impact do you think that has had in the industry, and how much do you believe that has contributed to us or black folks accepting their natural hair?
I think a lot.
Mm-hmm.
For one, it put braiders out there, and it made tourists going to the Caribbean island wanting something different and wanted that look, which they always do, a little bit more accepted, and they love it. So it made, economically, it made a little bit more difference for us in the Caribbean, because at the time, financial wise, it wasn't so predominant.
Mm-hmm.
And so that just opened so many doors, because everyone wanted that Bo Derek look. Everyone wanted it. It was the talk of the town. And so, in today, fast forward today, it's still very prevalent, because women are still visiting the Caribbean and still having their hair braided.
Here's another thing that I've noticed. Other cultures,
whether Italians, Asians, whatever, are sporting locks, braids. What do you attribute to the cultural crossover? Or what do you think it is?
I think one of my favorite reggae singers had a lot to do with that, and that's Bob Marley. I think that his music crossed genders and crossed barriers and crossed so many lines that it didn't matter the color, the creed, or your skin. Everyone was, to him, under the same roof, going through the same things. It doesn't matter where you're from. And so his music spoke to the masses. And you know, it's so funny. You meet someone and they know more about Bob Marley music than you would. And you're from the Caribbean. Mm-hmm. Isn't that funny?
It happens.
But I think Bob Marley just bridged that gap between the Caribbean and everyone else. And just kind of brought us together.
What advice would you give to someone who is not black, but is caring for a black child with natural hair?
I would say a lot of moisture. I was a member of a church in Atlanta, Georgia for a long time. It's called Liberty Church. And they're multicultured. Mm-hmm. And there was a couple whom I met that adopted three siblings from Haiti. And one of the siblings is a young girl. And I just noticed the couple just really struck me. They were sitting in front of me and they really struck me because the kids were hanging on to dad. Like they were so in love with the dad. And I just was like so overwhelmed with emotion just seeing that. And after service, I stopped them and I said, "Hi, how are you? Welcome to service. And you know, my name is Maxine." And then I said, after I welcomed them to the church, I said, "I'm also a hairdresser, so if you need any advice on the hair, let me know." And I think the next week I got her some products, and she was so happy about that. So for me, I just want, just hair care is important. Mm-hmm. So I think just reaching out, and it's okay to reach out. Don't feel like you can't because you're caring for, you know, African-American child in your home. I don't care like what the color of your skin is. Like, as long as you're a loving parent to that child, that's all that matters.
You mentioned color just now, right here, color. What advice do you have for clients, or how do you advise your clients against using a hair color that you know is not right for them, but they are passionate about having? How do you deal with that?
Well, one of the things that as a colorist and a hairdresser, and one of the things I strive for is healthy hair. And that's my main priority. So if a client is really looking for a color or really adamant about wearing a particular color that I feel wouldn't complement their skin tone, I give them reasons why. Because I think I don't want to only tell you should not use this, but I want to validate why you shouldn't use it. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And so I give them all the pros and cons. And I said, well, based on, you come to me for my professional opinion. So here is my professional opinion. And these are the reasons why. So I will not only tell you why, but I'm going to validate reasons why not to use the color. And then I'm going to choose something that will be complementary to your skin tone and ultimately make your eye color pop.
Have you ever had a client who insisted, regardless of what you show them, insisted that this is what they want, and then afterwards they were very upset with you about it?
Absolutely. But I've never done their hair.
Oh.
Because if you come to me, I feel like I've always used this scenario, and even when I am teaching in my classes, I always say, when you go to a doctor or a gynecologist or a dentist or whatever the case is, if whatever that doctor tells you to do is what you're going to do, whatever he prescribes is what you're going to use and you're going to drink because his word is gold, think of me as your doctor. I am on the same length or the same kind of wavelength as your doctor. If you come to me for advice regarding this particular color and I tell you no and you still insist on using that color, also thank you very much for your time, but I can perform that service.
But we know summer is here, and many will be heading for the beach, for
Absolutely.
The pools. Any advice for swimming with
color
or swimming with natural hair?
Yes, moisture. Chlorine water and salt water. While salt water is good for the skin and ultimately, in some retrospect, good for the hair, it can be a little damaging in terms of drying for the hair. So you want to make sure that you use a lot of moisture. Upon exiting the pool or the beach, you want to put a lot of conditioner. And I mean a really good hydrating conditioner, a good hydrated moisturizer. Just so your hair is not broken, it doesn't fall out.
This is after you leave?
After you leave the pool or the beach, yes.
Wow.
It keeps the integrity of the hair intact.
What do you like most about doing hair?
I get to play in people's hair.
is that why one of the reasons why you got into doing hair?
I get to play, no. What I love most about doing hair is the befores and afters.
Ah.
The befores are amazing, but the afters are spectacular. The befores and afters.
When's the last time you've done some hair, and after you're done, you said to yourself, I've outdone myself here. With all your experience, all that you have seen, when is the last time this has happened to you?
Last week. I was in Atlanta doing hair for a client. As a matter of fact, no, let me backtrack. That was an hour and a half ago. I had a client who was a referral from another client, and she came in and she had a full head of weave. And she said to me, I am thinning, I am on medication, I'm completely natural, but I don't want this in my hair anymore. And she said, I'm natural on the hair. And she had no idea what she was in for. And I, you know, took the weave down, I conditioned her, and I gave her some color, and I did her hair. And she looked totally different. And she's like, oh my God, I love it.
So, someone had asked me to ask you this. Do you prefer human hair or synthetic for extensions? And what are the advantages of human hair over synthetic?
It depends on the style.
Mm-hmm.
I think when you're wearing extensions, application is key. But in terms of a preference over human or synthetics, it really depends on the style of choice or the end result that you're looking for. So there's really no yes or no answer or yay or nay answer for that. It really just depends on the style. And then what are the advantages of using human versus synthetics?
Mm-hmm.
Human is a lot softer. You can do a lot more with human hair. It looks a lot more real than synthetic hair. And again, it just depends on the style.
Okay. Can you give our listeners some maintenance tips when wearing extensions?
Yes. Be sure to clean your scalp and make sure if you're wearing a full sew-in weave, then you want to make sure that you wash your hair at least once a week and make sure it's completely dry. If your scalp is not completely dry and the braids are not completely dry, you're going to develop a fungus, and that won't be good. Also, when you're wearing a full head extensions, whether it's braids or sew-in or weave or whatever you choose to call it, you want to be sure that the person applying it or installing it is just really diligent on the application. Treat your hair, deep treat it, get a trim before you even put anything in, and then once you take it out, do the same thing. And really take care of your scalp underneath. I think so many women wear extensions, and while there's nothing wrong with them, they don't take care of their hair underneath, and they neglect the hair, and so it leaves for breakage.
I want to ask you this question, and then we take a quick break.
Okay.
What goes through your mind when someone uses the term nappy hair?
Oh my God. I cannot take that word. I think it's such a derogatory word. Mm-hmm. First of all, no one has nappy hair. No one in the African American community has nappy hair. And I don't like when African Americans refer to themselves as, "I have nappy hair." You do not have nappy hair, first of all. It's so demeaning, and you can say the same, it's along the same lines as using the N-word. I don't like it. Mm-hmm. So don't refer to yourself as having nappy hair. Nappy hair goes back to me, for me, goes back to being enslaved. And enslaved, that's what we were called when we were enslaved. So I don't want to use it. And I ask my clients, and if you ask any of my clients, they know Maxine don't like that word nappy. Because there's no such thing as nappy hair.
Let's take a break.
Okay.
We are back with the lovely Maxine Green.
Maxine, for women who are concerned about keeping their own hair healthy while wearing a weave, which products do you recommend they use?
Shampoos and conditioners. I'm a very, without singling out anyone in particular, I really love Diva Curl No Poo. And here's my reasons why. It's paraben free. It has no silicones. There is no sulfates, and sulfate is a very drying and very harsh detergent. So I really like the No Poo. It's moisturizing, and I do like the Diva Curl One conditioner.
What reasons, if any, mm-hmm. would you give to anyone for not, or are there any reasons you would give to anyone for not wearing a weave? Any advice against it?
No, I can't say that I would. I would, however, want to know why you are. And many women wear weaves for many different reasons. One is because they just like it. And the other, it's just because it's easy for them to maintain. But if you're here for me, if your hair is natural and it's beautiful underneath, why cover it up? I just think women, when I think of natural hair, I just think being your authentic self. Being who you are, being who God made you to be. However you choose to wear your hair, it's just being your authentic self.
What are some mistakes you believe women who wear extensions make?
The first thing is that they don't take care of it. The other thing is they keep it in too long. I think when you keep extensions in the hair for a long period of time, it tends to lock the hair up, and dirt is then trapped into the braids. And so when you take it out, when you take the hair down, you tend to lose a lot more hair than you would normally would. So,
how do you stay up on trends?
I'm always in a class.
Is that so?
That's right. I am a firm believer in, this is my craft. This is not a hobby. You can read a book as a hobby. But this is my craft, this is my business, this is how I take care of my family, but it's also my passion, and I love it. I love every minute of it. And so just to keep abreast of what's going on, I'm always in a class. I teach as well as I take classes on my own.
You teach? How often do you teach?
As often as I'm available. I just taught a class in New Jersey yesterday.
And what is your class usually like? What do you really teach them?
I am a regional educator for Diva Shawn Salons, for Diva Concepts. Mm-hmm. And so I teach the Diva Curl method, which is cutting curly hair in its natural state, which is dry. And I also teach how to use their products.
Cutting curly hair in its natural state. That's mm-hmm. interesting. Mm-hmm. And so, what kind of hairstyles do you see are trending these days?
A lot of women are wearing their hair out, and You know what? It's so funny. I had locks for 15 years, and years ago, everything was about locks. There were so many, and it's still a very big lock community. There's so many women still wearing locks, but now it's transitioned to just wearing your hair free and out in the open. So I think that's the big trend right now. Women wearing their hair naturally curly and just big and free forming.
How do you see that? Do you see that as a freeing of the soul, a freeing of the self? Do you see it as a state, like when Afroforce came in, that was like a political, social political
right.
statement?
Mm-hmm.
What do you see it as a
woman? I just see it as being free.
Just being free.
Yeah, uninhibited, just being free to be who you are. No pretense, no worrying about what others might think. Just really owning it.
Some people still see weaves and extensions as a mm-hmm. stigma, a negative stigma. And,
mm-hmm.
What can you tell our listeners as to why they should not look at that as weaves or extensions in such a negative light?
I don't think anyone should.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's deemed as being, I think it's, for one, it's being deemed as negative because women tend to wear it a lot longer than their natural, their own hair. So everyone looks at it like, why is your hair so long? We know that's not all your hair. And I think that's the first thing. But women who tend to wear, I sometimes recommend weaves to my clients simply because they may be on medication and the medication is thinning their hair out and they feel self-conscious. And I think a lot of women wear their hair in these different extensions because for them it makes them feel beautiful. And it makes them feel pretty. But I feel like when women own who they are,
mm-hmm.
they don't need extensions or anything else to make them feel beautiful. You can be bald and be beautiful. So I don't think anyone should look at it in a negative light. Just own who you are.
Give us a success story. And let me see if I can set this up. Someone comes in to have their hair done.
Mm-hmm.
And, or have you ever had someone come over to you from another hairdresser who they claim might have messed their hair up and they would like you to fix it?
Mm-hmm.
And have you ever had that, and how did you proceed to do it and what was the result like?
I've never had that actually happen. What I've had happened is other clients, while I'm working on my current clients as they're sitting there waiting for their current hairdressers, is looking at what I'm doing and just comes over and go, what are you doing? And when I proceed to explain to them what I'm doing, they go, well, can I get that? Or I've had this done so often that I feel really blessed, really, really blessed and very fortunate. Clients, when they know someone who wants natural hair or want to shift to the natural hair journey, oh, I know someone you can go to. Her name is Maxine. She's amazing. And so my name just became synonymous with just natural hair.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's an awesome thing. I had an experience where in my current salon, a client came in for the owner, well, my colleague, and it was her first time there. She didn't know what she wanted. And she sat there and stared at me for like 2 hours. Every time she was looking, and she's like, what is she doing over there? So finally she got the courage and she came over and she goes, I'm sorry, I just can't stop staring. What is it that you're doing to her hair? And I was like, I'm just, you know, working on her natural texture. And she said, well, I have no chemicals in my hair and I don't want any. This is what I want. And she looked over and the hairdresser that she initially was scheduled to be with said, oh my God, please, sit in Maxine's chair, you're gonna be just fine. And that's how it started.
What still surprises you about how far you've come in your career?
That's a very good question. What surprises me? My growth.
Mm-hmm.
That I am where I am. I've had so many doors open for me. I've had a lot of doors closed as well. but I think the closed doors made the open ones so much, that much more sweeter. Just how far I've come in my career and where I am. I think that nothing is by chance. Absolutely not. I am where I am because this is where God wants me to be.
What drives you, Maxine?
My family. My family. Doing here, and this may sound a little cliche, but doing here, I feel, is my ministry. If I can pay it forward by blessing someone and making them feel and look amazing, I'm good. I can sleep good at night.
G in the chat room said, asks, what is your take, if any, on the controversy over Beyonce's daughter's hair?
That's a little girl. She's a baby. And so if the parents chooses to have her hair out in the open, I think her daughter's hair, Blue Ivy, is that her name,
yeah,
right? Blue Ivy's hair has nothing to do. It should be no concern of ours. We're not her folks. We're not her parents. That's concern for her parents. I think that we find so many fault and we try to find the negative in everything. And I just think that we just need to leave that baby alone. She's so innocent. She's such a baby. Just leave her be and let her parents deal with her and her hair. However they choose to have their daughter wear their hair is their choice, not ours to be to comment on.
You teach.
I do.
You travel between Atlanta and New York.
I do.
Different hair salons.
I do.
People sit in salons and stare at you, curious about what you're doing. So you interact a lot with people. Mm-hmm. What impact would you say you're having on young people today with what you do?
The impact that I hope that I'm having is that go for what you want. Believe in yourself. And that's the first thing I tell anyone. Believe in who you are. And stay true to yourself. When you stay true to yourself, there's nothing no one can do or say about you.
Has anyone ever come to you and said, Maxine, because of you, I want to do hair?
Yes. I'm going to tell you, share a story with you. I had a previous client of mine who, while I was living in Atlanta, I went to a brunch. She had a birthday brunch, and I went to a brunch, and it was myself and seven other women.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the girls across the table from me introduced herself. Oh, you're Maxine. I keep hearing so much about you. And I said, well, it's so nice to meet you. Well, anyhow, at the end of the brunch, we all had a good time. And maybe 2 or 3 days later, I got an email from the young lady's sister-in-law. And the email said, I got your information from my sister-in-law who met you and thought you were amazing. And we understand that they were mutual friends. I guess my client is her friend. And so we know that you're Veronica's hairdresser. I just want to reach out to you because I'm having a bit of a struggle with my own business. This is what I do for a living, and I wanted to know if I can shadow you or train with you. And I was like, wow. I was actually moved by that. I was taken back. I was like, whoa. You know, I was like, little old me. I was just kind of taken back. I guess I was being a little meek about it, but I was very humbled and moved by her email. And so I reached out to her, and we sat on the phone for about 3 hours talking. And so every time right before I moved back to New York, I had the young lady come and shadow me. She was my assistant, and I taught her everything I knew. And
wonderful.
She told me all the time, she's like, thank you so much. I've learned so much from you. Just not only from a stylist standpoint, but how to be a professional stylist. Because I think oftentimes, as stylists, hairdressers, we are at the bottom of the totem pole. We're not looked at as being a professional career, but we are. And so we're taken for granted more often than we would like. So I told her, just stay true to who you are and stand in your truth.
Mm-hmm. Is that really so now? I seem to be like a shift
in perception, still very much so.
Still very much the case. I think there's no value on a hairdresser's. There's no, oh, it's just a hairdresser. But finding a good hairdresser is like finding a good doctor. Ultimately, you want someone who will treat your hair and take care of your hair the same way she would treat hers. And that's what you should look for in a hairdresser. Someone who is very conscientious of your time and values your time.
If you had a chance to do a famous person's hair, mm-hmm. or two,
uh-huh.
who would you want to do?
Hannah, from The Haves and the Haves Not. Crystal, I think her name is. I'm not sure of her last name. But I'm not sure if Hannah.
Well, let's send that out there.
Yes.
Anna, Maxine would like to do your hair.
Yes. Tyler Perry. Hannah.
What?
I think she has gorgeous hair. Yeah.
What maintenance advice do you have for women sporting a natural look?
Moisture
again.
Yes. Mm-hmm. African American texture tends to be a lot more drier. When you're wearing your hair in its natural state, it looks and feels a lot more brittle. And there's so many factors that can contribute to your hair being more dry. And one of those is the weather, the climate change. We sleep on cotton pillows and, you know, we're leaning our heads against the bedposts and the, you know, coats and different things. So you want to make sure that your hair is always moisturized. If it's not moisturized and hydrated, your hair will tend to break and be a lot more brittle. So if you're mindful of the moisture level in your hair, you will not go wrong with that.
Moisturize with what?
You can moisturize where there's so many different things that you can use as a moisturizer. One of my favorite things to moisturize the hair is, I currently love Design Essentials Daily Moisturizer. I think it has jojoba oil and is very hydrated. I love the feel of that in the hair. I also think that people can use different oils, a combination of mixed oils, and they can use that to saturate their scalp at night and just moisturize it with that. And also do a steam treatment, like a deep treatment ever so often to get the moisture back into the hair.
Have you ever thought of mixing your own oils?
I've thought of creating my own products, yes.
So we anticipate seeing this sometime
soon. Stay tuned.
Okay, wonderful. Well, what advice do you have for those who are confused about hair products? And give us three of your favorite hair products.
Confused about products, in terms of if a client is confused or any consumer is confused about products, I would say there's so much. I think the market is saturated with natural hair care products. Mm-hmm. And while that's good for the manufacturers, it's not good for the consumers. A lot of manufacturers is targeting the urban community because, one, we spend so much more money than anyone else on our hair. We just want to look and feel good. But is it right for our hair? Is all these products that are available, is it right for our hair? No. I think that, in my professional opinion, I think no. I think you have to start doing your due diligence and read the labels. If you can't pronounce the word and you Google it and you can't get a true definition of the word, don't use it in your hair. Because ultimately it's going on your scalp and it's seeping through your pores. And there's so many factors. In the African American community, we suffer from a high rate of fibroids. Fibroids is a muscle, and there's so many reasons why we have fibroids. And it's at an alarming rate why so many of us, including myself, has fibroids. And so we have to look at all these different ingredients in the products. So I would say really do your due diligence in terms of researching products. In terms of my favorites, three of my top three favorite products to use, one of them is Diva Shawn or Diva Curl products. I love their products simply because I know what's in them. It's really moisturizing. I use it on myself. I use it on all my clients. I use it on my daughter. I like Design Essentials because I get consistency from Design Essentials, and I love consistency. If I can guarantee a client would look amazing every time she sits in my chair, then I'm going to use that product. I love Design Essentials. I also like Uncle Funky's daughter. I know it's a
Uncle
little...
Funky's daughter?
I know it's a little funky, but this young lady is based out of Houston, Texas, and she has a really amazing product, and it's really good. It's borderline organic, but it's really hydrating, mm-hmm. and I love it.
What do you say to those who ask, why change my hair to natural hairstyle? Many will laugh at me.
People only laugh at you when you allow them to. Or people only laugh at you because you're not comfortable in your skin.
If you could go back in time to when you first started doing hair, mm-hmm. and you can change something, what would you change?
That I did not, when I went natural more than 16 years ago, the only product on the market at the time was Carol's daughter. And this is when she was on Atlantic Avenue. Carol's daughter was not as big as she is today. And so to see the shift in where we were then and where we are today is mind-blowing to me. Mm-hmm. What I would change, I don't think I would change anything. I locked my hair years ago and I had my locks for 15 years. I loved my locks. I owned my locks. I maintained my locks myself and I loved it. I wouldn't change anything.
One question before the break. Mm-hmm. You're an educator.
Correct.
What is your underlying message to young women and young girls? About their hair.
Not even in a general underlining message for them. I just want young people to really, and I tell my daughter all the time, just be yourself. People will love you regardless of who you are. Just really be yourself. Be yourself. You don't have to pretend to be someone else. Be your true self. And I think that just goes back to, I love the word authentic. Because for me, it's just like a fabric. It's your natural self.
We are back with the lovely Maxine Green. Maxine, if a woman is bored with her hair, what's your advice for a quick and easy style switch to get her out of that rut?
Whether she's wearing it natural or straight or have extensions, I say try something new. Try a new style or sometimes a little change in color. Sometimes a little color will add some freshness to her face and just ultimately some freshness to her. Color is always good. I say throw some color in there.
Do you enjoy working with colors?
I do. I love it. I dream in color.
Really?
I love being a colorist. Colorist gives me the ability to change the look. You can change a look with a hairstyle, any hairstyle. But when you add hair color, it adds depth and dimension. And I love that.
Why do people wrap their hair? And this is a guy that asked me to ask you this question.
Mm-hmm.
Why do women wrap their hair at night?
If you're not sleeping on a satin pillow, which you should be, you need to have your hair tied up in a silk scarf. One, if you don't, your hair will dry out. The cotton pillow dries your hair out. It will also add breakage to your hair. So you want to preserve the moisture into your hair because our hair loses so much moisture when you're sleeping on the cotton pillow. It just takes away a lot from it. Makes it a lot, the fabric changes almost. So women tend to wrap up their hair at night to cover or to preserve or protect a style.
What do you say to guys like myself who have natural hair?
Mm-hmm.
Can't be bothered with all that stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Just don't put no moisturizer, just can't be bothered with wrapping no hair and so on.
You're
just
a guy.
Want to be free.
You're a guy and it's okay.
Okay.
I think men that wear their hair out natural, such as yourself, I think it's beautiful. It's almost as if it's empowering to me. It's liberating.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel the same way for women who wear their hair not touched, or it's almost so much more freeing and liberating. Guys don't have to worry about moisture. He's a man. He does a man thing.
Yeah, I'm like, moisture.
Yeah, moisture. Moisture, why? As long as you use a good moisturizing shampoo.
Uh-huh.
That, I would say, yes. But in terms of maintenance and moisture for yourself, that's not necessarily...
I would lose, because yeah. There's no way I would do that. No
you
way.
Would lose.
No
yeah,
way.
I would say, yeah.
If you had a bucket list, right, of mm-hmm. things that you have to do before mm-hmm. you die, what are two or three things you're craving to do?
Two or three things that I am craving to do. I love to travel.
Uh-huh.
I do. I love to travel. And one of the places I would love to go to is Sydney, Australia. I don't know why. I'm just fascinated with Sydney. The other thing is, I admire Oprah for what she does and what she's doing. And one of the things I love of her shows is Super Soul Sundays. And mm-hmm. I feel like it's such food for thought, food for the soul. And I think that was what her agenda was. And I love that. I love that. And so if I can create a platform for women where it's something like Super Soul Sundays, but make it a Super Soul Hair Sunday or a workshop, just really having women own themselves and really embrace themselves. Because I think there's so much pain and hurt in our community. Mm-hmm. And I think once we get past that, we'll be fine.
I want to shift a little bit. I know there's about hair, but I want to shift. Mm-hmm. Now that you've mentioned that, you are in the presence of many women
mm-hmm.
several times a week.
Right.
And in barbershops and beauty salons where men and women just, no pun intended, let their hair down.
Right.
And just talk.
Right.
What are some things that women are saying that might surprise us, men?
Mm-hmm.
Things that, some, okay, let's do it this way. Two or three things they admire in us
mm-hmm.
that we are not necessarily aware of. And two or three things they don't like about us mm-hmm. that we are not necessarily aware of.
The women I've come across and I've worked with, whether they're colleagues or clients,
mm-hmm.
are the talk is they love a man with confidence. Mm-hmm. I think any woman does, including myself. I think confidence exudes such richness in a man. When you're confident in who you are, it shines through. So everything else doesn't matter. Confidence is key. Women like men, or women love men who are honest with themselves and therefore can be honest with their partner.
Mm.
So there's a lot to be said. I think it's unfortunate, but I've noticed a lot of women, especially in the African-American community, we settle for mediocrity. And that could be within our personal lives as well as our professional lives. But specifically more so in our personal life.
Mm-hmm.
And I noticed that when our personal lives are not in tune in what or in line and what we want it to be, everything else falls apart. So we look for men with confidence. And we talk about men with confidence. And we admire men with confidence. We admire men who are good dressers. But I'm sure most men knows that. We admire men who are great providers, who are great dads. There's a lot of, as Ayanna Van Zandt would say, there's a lot of fatherless sons and fatherless daughters who are seeking and looking for someone to fill that void and that need. And so the conversation always arises about broken homes and broken marriages. And so it's heartbreaking.
in the black community, well, not just the black community, but let's speak to the black community. Young boys sagging, right? For instance, what are the young girls who are maturing? Are they talking about it? Are they talking against it? How what are their some of their views about men who sag?
I am not sure if they are talking about it or if they're viewing about it. But what I can say is the ones that I come across, the young women, that is, they are appalled because it's not attractive. And I'm very vocal in terms of my opinions and where I stand with certain beliefs. And that's one of the things that I don't tolerate. I have a 16-year-old son who I will not have him sagging. It's I don't know if they know the true meaning or where it originated from and why men sag. But the young women who cross paths with me or who I've had the opportunity to sit and talk to, I will let them know that that's not attractive. That's not something that you should be looking for in a partner. Or even if it's in a meantime sort of relationship, that's not something you want to attract.
What still surprises you about yourself as a hairstylist?
What still surprises me as a hairdresser? What surprises me is clients.
Clients.
I think that women have someone's, it's almost as if this preconceived notion or this, I want this, but it's really not attainable. So they want a particular look or a particular color, but it's really not recommended or it's really not, or you get the clients who come in and they give you a picture of a celebrity. And, you know, I'm like, well, you know, no pun intended, but I'm not the celebrity stylist. I can do my best to achieve what you're looking for. However, do you know most of that, of celebrities wear extensions? So half the time it's not their own hair. It's extensions to create that look. So in essence, what you're looking for is your idea or a vision of what you think is beautiful for you.
Do you have any female heroes and or sheroes? And if so, who are some of them?
Maya Angelou. My favorite author, and I'll tell you why. My life changed and shift when I first read I Know Why the Caged Bird Sings. I was 14 years old, and I was in high school. And I read that book, and it was part of a book project.
Wow.
And it changed my life.
What is the core of what you got from that?
Speak up for what you want.
And you do that to this day?
I may not do it immediately, but I would at some point. I will. If someone I feel has wronged me, I will let them know. I try not to hold on to things because I feel that it becomes a detrimental to who you are. And so if I am preaching or talking about being my true authentic self, then holding on to something is not really being true to who I am. So if you wronged me in any way, I will speak up. And I think I have a voice. I should use it.
Give us a glimpse into a day of the life of Maxine Green. As the hairstylist, the mother, and then just as a woman chilling out in Brooklyn or Atlanta.
A day in the life of Maxine is chaotic. On the days that I'm not working, I am lounging because I'm exhausted. I love to cook. I love to cook. And now I have a 12-year-old who loves to cook, and she cooks better than I do. But the days I'm not doing anything, I love to cook. I maybe read in a book, or in the computer, researching, or I'm in a class on my day off. When I am not working, or when I am working, I'm a day in the life in Atlanta. It starts at 8 a.m. or 9 a.m. and my day can go as long as 10, 11. Because when I go to Atlanta for that time, I am busy.
Do you ever get tired of doing this, frustrated? Do you ever feel like, I've had enough of here, I want to do something else?
Right now, no.
Mm-hmm.
Right now, I am thinking of ways to propel to the next level.
What does the next level look like to you?
The next level for me would be ultimately teaching more women. Mm-hmm. Teaching more women about their hair and embracing their hair. I hope one day to open my own salon. It's always been a dream of mine.
You will have it.
To open my own salon.
You will. I can see the determination and passion in your eyes. You will. So, if you are in front of several young ladies,
mm-hmm.
preteen, teenagers, early 20s,
mm-hmm.
and the chatter among them before you started to speak to them is about their hair.
Mm-hmm.
Some saying, look, I prefer a process. I want to look pretty.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Some saying, well, I'm sick and tired of putting stuff in my hair. I want to look natural.
Right.
I like that.
Right.
Another saying, well, we're not sure what we want to do. But what we do know is the question they ask you, or they're asking, is how could my hair really help me feel confident and, you know, strong and courageous? What would your conversation with them be like?
First of all, no one can give you confidence.
Mm-hmm.
Confidence is something that you have to build on your own. As I would love to say that I can give you confidence and say that, you know, you can go buy it, but you can't. What I can do is I can build that personal.
Mm-hmm.
You are beautiful. I think every woman, regardless of age, is beautiful in their own right. In whatever form or shape or size they have, they're beautiful. And I think that so many women don't find themselves pretty because they were never told, or they don't believe it. So I think self-confidence has a lot to do with what was never told to them. So if I can build someone up and say, my darling, you're beautiful, regardless of the texture of your hair or how you want to wear it. Now, if you're looking to go natural, I can help you on that journey. I can tell you what to use, how to use it. Let me bless you by doing your hair and show you. And I think it starts there.
What is one thing about you, Maxine, that most people do not know that might surprise them? It doesn't have to be anything out there,
mm-hmm.
but something about you, something about your personality, something that either you like to do or not like to, but something about you that would surprise a lot of people if they found out.
I'm a big kid. I love cartoons.
What?
I love cartoons.
What about them?
My favorite cartoon is Thundercats. I love the female character. I thought she was strong. I thought she was confident. And she held her own amongst the guys. And I love that.
Mm.
I'm a big kid. I'm a huge kid.
What is gratifying about being Maxine?
What is gratifying about being Maxine? I'm blessed.
Mm.
I'm blessed beyond my wildest dreams.
Looking back, if you had a chance to change anything about your education, your experiences, anything, what would you change?
I wouldn't. I wouldn't change anything. There is nothing is by coincidence and nothing is by chance. And we are who we are in the space in our lives for different reasons. And I think that ultimately it could either make you or break you, and it shapes who you are currently. And I wouldn't change anything. I think my past experiences makes me who I am today.
Let's take a quick break.
Okay.
We are back with Maxine Green. Maxine, what kind of music calms you down?
I like the soothing R&B, but currently my hubby introduced me to Tarris Riley, and I love his music.
Terrence Riley.
Yes, Tarris Riley.
Mm. Good taste.
So.
Good taste.
It's awesome.
When are you most happy?
When I'm with my family.
Is there a particular story your children always tell about you?
I don't know. That's a good one. I don't know. I've never heard them tell a story in particular about me.
What advice do you have for young people wanting to pursue a career in hairstyling?
Go for it. The hair industry or the beauty industry, there's so many, it's such a vast industry. And there's so many different areas that you can be and be a blessing to someone. And I mean blessing. When I say blessing, many people come into the industry for different reasons. But if your reasons are to help ultimately and bless someone, then you will succeed. If you come in it for financial reasons, everybody wants to be financially stable. Yes, ultimately you want to make money at what you do, because if you're being realistic about it. But don't go about it for just the money. You will not succeed. I say go for it.
What are you most proud of?
I am most proud of my children.
Uh-huh.
And I am proud of myself for sticking to what I believe in and what I love and holding my ground.
As a stylist, a hairstylist.
As a stylist, as a mom, as a friend, as a sister, just sticking to me, just being me.
And as those things, especially a stylist, what is one thing you absolutely cannot do without?
My hubby.
Yeah, okay. Well, that's a person. Give me a thing. In your wardrobe. Something.
Wardrobe, a girl's best friend. Thing that I can't do without. You know what? This is going to sound so off the cuff, but it's the truth. I cannot do without my Candy Yum Yum. It's favorite lipstick.
Finish this sentence, Maxine.
Mm-hmm.
I look forward to Sunday evenings too.
Just relax.
Have we seen the best of Maxine?
Not yet. It's a work in progress.
What are you most thankful for?
Just waking up.
If you could go back in time, what would you tell the 16-year-old Maxine?
It's okay.
It's okay.
It gets better. It's okay. It gets better.
What are your fondest memories of your parents as a child?
I met my dad when I was 13 and a half years old for the first time.
Mm-hmm.
Prior to that, I didn't know who he was. And after that, I still don't know who he is. I don't have a relationship with him. Yet I don't feel a need or a void. I'm very fortunate to not have a need or felt the need to have my dad around. I just kind of said, okay, well, he's not there and it's okay. And I never made it a priority. In terms of my mom used to travel and trade a lot. My mom grew up in Guyana, and she used to travel from Guyana to the States and get stuff and bring it back and sell it in Guyana. And so the one thing that she bought me back on her last trip was a stuffed Mickey Mouse doll. And I'll never forget it. And that was the day I fell in love with Disney.
Wow. Now this is a question I ask everyone. What makes you laugh out loud?
What makes me laugh out loud? I laugh out loud at just how I'm in awe of God's mercy. I'm in awe of His grace. Because without Him, I wouldn't be where I am.
Is there any parting words, anything you would like to say?
Yeah. Stay true to who you are and be blessed.
Maxine, I want to say thank you. Thank you so much for coming on CWS and sharing your experiences with us.
Thank you for having me. It was awesome.
You're quite welcome. Anything surprised you about CWS?
How relaxing it is.
Oh, man. How relaxed. Well, thank you so much, Maxine. You're now a woman of CWS. And
awesome.
We ask you to come back at some point.
Awesome. Would love to.
Thank you. All right. Good night.
Good night.